Good afternoon. Welcome to our lecture program. I am Kostas Zanos, Vice President and Chair of the Program Committee of Hellenic Link Midwest. Our lecture program extends from October to May. We do not hold any lectures during the months of June, July, August, and September. These are the months that our members take their vacation and many of us enjoy the summer in Greece. Today's lecture is the last one in our program until next October. I wish to all of you an enjoyable summer and look forward to seeing you again in October. Our speaker this afternoon is Dr. Nikos Nikoloudis, who joins us from Athens, Greece. His lecture is supported by the Hellenic Foundation Chicago. The support of the foundation is greatly appreciated. Dr. Nikoloudis holds a doctoral degree from the Center of Byzantine and Modern Greek Studies at King's College, London. He has taught history courses at the college year in Athens, the Athens School for Tourist Guides, and the YWCA, as well as postgraduate seminars at the Athens Institute for Education and Research. His area of research interests include military and socio-political history in Greece, medieval and modern times, in Southern Europe, the Middle East, and the Mediterranean. He has served as editor-in-chief of the journal Historical Themata. He has co-authored two textbooks for the Hellenic Open University and has published 13 books and many articles. As always, we will close the lecture with a questions and answers session. You can type your questions at any time by clicking the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. This will open another screen where you can type your questions. Those who attend the event on Facebook, you can type your questions on the comments box on the left or at the bottom of the screen. Dr. Nikoloudis, the screen is yours.
Good evening from Athens, and I would like to express my gratitude once again to the Hellenic Link Midwest for the kind invitation. Today's lecture will be fully on PowerPoint, so I would like to ask our audience to follow it more easily, not to necessarily try and read what's in each slide, the PowerPoint, but rather listen to my narration of it. In any case, we'll be able to go back and forth at the question and answer section if there is any need for that. But let me start by saying that the context of my lecture involves the general situation in the former Ottoman Empire in the period from the end of the, or rather beginning with the First World War and going through it quickly, and essentially from 1918, the year of the armistice, until 1922, terminating with the destruction of Smyrna, which essentially put an end to the Greek-Turkish War and settled de facto the Asia Minor question. Let's start then by showing you this general map of the Ottoman Empire during the First World War. You see the Ottoman Empire, and the dotted line is the famous railroad going from Berlin to Baghdad, or rather intended to go so there. The Ottoman Empire was still holding Eastern Thrace and a large section of the Middle East. The Ottomans entered the First World War following a raid of two Ottoman cruisers on Russian Black Sea ports. On the 13th of November of 1914, that is about 2 weeks after the raid, the Ottoman raid, the Sultan Mehmed V, who as a caliph of Muslims worldwide, declared the holy war against infidels. And again, from December 1914, a couple of weeks later, until January 1915, The Ottomans launched a strong campaign in the Caucasus against the Russians, but were defeated decisively in the Battle of Sarikamish with a loss of approximately 100,000 men. And that, in turn, led to a Russian conquest of the northwest Anatolia, Armenia, and eastern Pontus, including Trebizond. Here we have a photo of the declaration of the Holy War, the Jihad, by Sheikhul Islam, the top clergyman in the Ottoman Empire. And here we go on with a brief summary of what happened during World War I in the area of the Ottoman Empire. From February 1915 and almost for a whole year until January 1916, we have the famous Battle of Gallipoli, which ended with the Ottomans securing possession of the Dardanelles and blocking military support for Russia through the Dardanelles. Around the same time of the beginning of the campaign, on the 24th of April 1915, the Armenian genocide starts in the Ottoman Empire following the arrest of prominent Armenians in Constantinople. Then, at the end of the year, around December 1915 and until April 1916, there was a stronger British advance in the Mesopotamia from starting from India, which, however, was halted after the Ottoman siege of the town of Kut El Amara on the River Tigris and the surrender of its 8,000 British defenders. However, in the following year, in 1916, we have the famous Arab revolt instigated by Lawrence of Arabia, which destabilized Ottoman control over the Arabian Peninsula and the Arab desert. 1 year later, in 1917, the Russian Revolution facilitated Ottoman advances in the Caucasus and the reconquest of the Pontus as a result of the collapse of the Russian army. This could not stop the defeat of the Ottoman Empire, the eventual defeat, because in December 1917, Jerusalem was captured by the British. And in September 1918, the collapse of the Macedonian front posed an imminent threat to Constantinople. To make things a little easier, I'm showing you here a map of the hostilities during World War I in the Middle East. You can see in the Mediterranean section, the advance, the Entente advance reaching as far as Aleppo and Alexandretta, this present Iskenderun. And on the further to the east, the British advancing to the town, the city of Mosul, capturing almost two thirds of present Iraq. Further up to the north, you can see the line separating the Ottomans from the Russians. The Ottomans had retaken most of the eastern provinces inhabited by the Turks. On 13th of October 1916, the Ottoman surrendered as a result of the resignation of the triumvirate managing the Ottoman affairs, that is the leadership of the Committee of the Union and Progress Party, better known as the Young Turks. On the 13th of October 1918, an Ottoman delegation under Minister of Navy Rauf Bey visited the British Admiral Calthorpe on HMS Agamemnon, anchored in Mudros Bay in Limnos, and signed an armistice taking effect the following day. Here we see to the left Admiral Calthorpe, and on the right, the Ottoman delegation with Rauf Bey here on first to the left, seated. And for your information, again, we have here the Ottoman text to the left and the English text to the final lines and signature of the signatories. There followed an immediate, almost immediate Allied occupation of Constantinople, despite the fact that the Ottoman delegation was left with the understanding that no foreign troops were to enter Constantinople. However, on the 13th of November, Allied troops did enter the Ottoman capital, and eventually the Entente allies established high commissioners in the Ottoman capital to supervise their affairs with the Ottomans. On the same day, on the 13th of November 1918, the Greek battle cruiser Averof, which was the flagship of the Greek Navy, sailed to Constantinople with other Allied warships that raised the flags of their countries in the Ottoman capital. And here we have two pictures of the Allied troops entering Constantinople. To the left, British troops marching at the Bayoglu district. And to the right, the French General Franchet d'Esperey, who was commander of Allied Army of the Orient, entering Constantinople in 8 February 1919. The big issue then was what was to become of the Ottoman Empire. And here you have to go on a flashback to see what France, Great Britain, and Russia had in mind during the First World War. These three powers had negotiated a settlement for a partition of the Ottoman Empire. On the 3rd of January 1916, they concluded a secret agreement on the partition of the Ottoman Empire in Asia, in the context of which Russia was allowed to control Constantinople and the Straits. This was the famous Sykes-Picot Agreement, named after its authors, Mark Sykes, an English diplomat and politician, and François-Georges Picot, a French diplomat. It was ratified in early May 1916, but it was only revealed to the world almost a year and a half later, on the 23rd of November 1917, by the Russian Bolsheviks, who had overthrown the Tsarist regime, as you know. And here you have two pictures of Mark Sykes on the left and Georges Picot on the right. Now, this is the interesting bit of the agreement, the map which shows how the Asian territories were supposed to be partitioned. In dark blue, in this area here, we see on the northwest of the Middle East, we see French occupation of eastern provinces of Turkey. In the light blue, the area of Syria and northern Iraq, the French were supposed to have a direct control. Further to the north, in the green area, we see the proposed Russian territory, which would include eastern Pontus with Trebizond and eastern Turkey and Armenia, parts of Armenia. In red, on the southeast, we have direct British occupation of southeastern Iraq, more or less. And on pink, the rest of Iraq and a large section of present Jordan. With mauve in the southwestern corner, the area of Palestine was supposed to be under international control. So a few months later, on the 19th of April 1917, Britain, France, and Italy this time reached a new agreement in the town of Saint-Jean-de-Maurienne on the French Alps. And that was signed gradually by all three of them during August and September 1917, extending the Sykes-Picot arrangement to include Italy. Russia was not did not have time to consent because of its collapse with the February Revolution of 1917. And in this map, you can see the new arrangements which included Italy in the Sykes-Picot arrangement. In A and B, we see the areas under French and British control accordingly, and the other colors, the territories that were supposed to be occupied by these powers. And we have a new arrangement, the southern part of Turkey would be taken by Italy, controlled directly, and the sea area, which included Smyrna and its interior, would be an area of Italian control. I remind you that this time the Dodecanese, adjacent to southeastern Turkey, southwestern Turkey, were already under Italian control after the Italian-Turkish War of 1911-12. What was the situation of Greece during that time? King Constantine, at the beginning of the First World War, and Prime Minister Venizelos were in agreement that Greece should be neutral. But eventually, they started having different views as to how Greece should view the war vis-a-vis the opposite coalitions of the Entente and the Central Powers. Venizelos believed that Greece should join the Entente, while King Constantine favored neutrality all the way, and in 1915 dismissed Venizelos unconstitutionally. However, in 1917, King Constantine was forced to abdicate by the French and the English. Venizelos took power and Greece joined the Entente, sending 9 divisions to the Macedonian front. In 1917, when the peace conference started, Greece aimed at realizing the Megalithea, for the great idea, which would incorporate the annexation by Greece of regions with ethnically Greek or Greek Orthodox populations in the Balkans and Asia Minor, these being northern Epirus, present southern Albania, Thrace, western Turkey, the Dodecanese, and Cyprus. According to Venizelos, Greeks living in the Ottoman lands numbered around 2 million people. What was the situation of these people, though? Going back again at the beginning of the First World War, or rather in 1914 and earlier, it is interesting to note that after the successful coup of the Young Turks in 1908, when they took control of the Ottoman government, Ottoman Greeks enjoyed a brief spell of political freedom. And during the Balkan War, some of them served in sensitive posts. For example, the so-called Nikolaki Effendi, a lieutenant in the Ottoman army, who served in the Ioan garrison in 1912 and 13, and was a contributor to the Greek victory by revealing the Greek, the Ottoman arrangements of the fort fortifications to the Greek general staff. According to the Treaty of Athens, which was signed on the 14th of November 1913, and terminated hostilities between Greece and the Ottoman Empire, the status of the Eastern Aegean Islands, which had been taken over by the Greek fleet, remained unresolved. And for this reason, perhaps, Ottoman Greeks became scapegoats for the extensive territorial losses of the Ottoman Empire in Europe. In 1914, already even before the beginning of the entrance of Turkey in the First World War, there occurred extensive persecution of Greeks in Eastern Thrace and Western Asia Minor that forced thousands of them to seek refuge in the liberated Greek territories. The Young Turks put in action a clandestine pogrom measures which ranged from boycotting Greek products and businesses to open killings, looting, etc. A prominent example is the so-called massacre of Phokia on the 12th of June 1914. This, I remind you, is even before the official beginning of the First World War, which started a month later. A typical example of anti-Greek pogroms in Western Asia Minor. Phokia was a town of 8,400 people, most of them, the 8,000 were Greeks and the 400 were Turks, at a distance of approximately 43 kilometers northwest of Smyrna. During the summer of 1914, genocidal persecutions occurred in the vilayets of Aydin and Izmir. And on the 12th of June, irregular Turkish band suddenly attacked Phokia. The events then were witnessed and recorded by quite a few foreigners. The main witnesses were the French archaeologists Félix Artio and Charles Mancier, who were inhabitants of the town and they were excavating the ruins of ancient Phokia nearby. Later recordings were made by Harry Stürmer, a German correspondent of the Kölnische Zeitung newspaper, and George Horton, the US consul in Smyrna. Here we have two pictures of Sartio to the left, who took pictures, as we'll see soon, and Horton to the right. Here we have a picture to the left of the destruction of Phokia, and to the right, a brief report of the New York Times, published in a few days later, on the 17th of June 1914, revealing the massacre to the American public. Here's what Mancier said about the massacre as recorded by Horton. During the night, the organized bands continued the pillage of the town. At the break of dawn, there was continual trenary firing before the houses. Going out immediately, we saw the most atrocious spectacle. From all directions, the Christians were rushing to the quays, seeking boats to get away in, but since the night, there were none left. The panic was so great that a woman with her child was drowned in 60 centimeters of water. Here we have two revealing pictures. To the left, a dead Greek woman on the seashore, and to the right, triumphant Ottoman bandit with his loot marching through the coastal of the across the street of the town. The outcome of the Euphorcia's program. The massacre continued until the 18th of June. The Greeks killed varied from 50 to 200, and the survivors, approximately 6,000, were evacuated by two Greek steamboats to neighboring Lesbos. The population of the surrounding country was reduced during this period from 23,000 to just 4,000 people. Around the same time, we have a persecution of Greeks also in the Pontic region. Incidents there started as early as the autumn of 1914, as recorded by the picture to the right from the Maryborough Chronicle of Queensland, dating from the 25th of November. And the persecution intensified due to the proximity of the Pontus to the Caucasian front. The main contributor to our knowledge of these events was Henry Morgenthau, the US ambassador to the Ottoman Empire in the period 1913 to 16, who consistently recorded the persecution of Greeks in the period up to January 1916, which was the time when he left the Ottoman Empire. Morgenthau stated the following: everywhere the Greeks were gathered in groups and under the so-called protection of Turkish gendarmes, they were transported, the largest part on foot, into the interior. Just how many were scattered in this fashion is not definitely known, the estimates varying anywhere from 200,000 up to 1 million. These caravans suffered great privations, but they were not submitted to general massacre. The Greeks, unlike the Armenians, had a government which was vitally interested in their welfare. At this time, there was general apprehension that Greece would enter the war on the side of the Entente, and a wholesale massacre of Greeks in Asia Minor would unquestionably have produced such a state of mind in Greece that its pro-German king would have been unable longer to keep his country out of war. Persecutions continued again in December 1916. The persecution was intensified due to the occupation of Eastern Aegean islands by the Entente earlier in that year. I may remind you that Greece was officially neutral, but Entente had taken over parts of northern Greece and the easternmost Aegean islands neighboring Turkey because it wanted to secure that it would not be threatened by any sudden Greek political decisions to join the Central Powers. In January 1917, Talat Pasha, who was the interior minister of the Young Turk government, ordered the removal of Samson Greeks in the Pontus 30 to 50 kilometers inland. Thus, 30,000 Greeks were deported to Ankara despite protests of Bishop Germanos Karavangelis. In March 1917, all Greek inhabitants of Ivalik, which was on the other part of Turkey, in the Aegean coast, around 30,000 people were removed forcibly to Anatolia's interior on orders of the German general Lehmann von Sanders. Lehmann von Sanders was in charge of the defense of the Gallipoli during the famous campaign. And of course, he could see a possibility of sabotage, perhaps, by Greeks on the western coast of Turkey. This is how a British diplomat reported on the persecution of Greeks during World War I. In the course of these Ottoman persecutions, it is largely agreed that about 1.5 million Armenians perished and that over 500,000 Greeks were deported, of whom comparatively few survived. Now, going forward again to the Paris Peace Conference, to give you a general idea, that was dominated by the Big Four from left to right, as we see the photograph: British Prime Minister David Lloyd George, the Italian Prime Minister Vittorio Emanuele Orlando, French Prime Minister Georges Clemenceau, and the American President Woodrow Wilson. And here we have a poster of the period soon after the end of the First World War, which shows some of the prominent figures on the Allied side, including Venizelos on the bottom left corner as a major war leader. The potential allies of Venizelos and Greece in the Paris Conference was Lloyd George and Woodrow Wilson. Venizelos had a preference for the British for reasons explained by an American correspondent, who stated that Venizelos decided that the only policy for the Greek delegation was to play with the British. The Italians were hostile to all Greek aspirations. The French would have to subordinate their Balkan and Turkish policies to the changing exigencies of the German and Russian situation. The Americans were without a definite policy. Great Britain was an essential factor. Military considerations, political considerations, economic considerations dictated to Athens firm and fast friendship with London. As stated by Herbert Adam Gibbons, an American correspondent to Turkey, as I said, who was also a later biographer of Venizelos. What were President Wilson's post-war plans for the Ottoman Empire? On the basis of point 12 of his famous 14 points, that is principles, as stated on January 8, 1918, quote, the Turkish portions of the present Ottoman Empire should be assured a secure sovereignty, but the other nationalities which are now under Turkish rule should be assured an undoubted security of life and an absolutely unmolested opportunity of autonomous development, and the Dardanelles should be permanently opened as a free passage to the ships and commerce of all nations under international guarantees. However, there were many there was a certain vagueness on in the context of points 12, stated by Margaret Macmillan, modern Canadian historian, who wrote, what were the Turkish portions? Who should have autonomous development? The Arabs, the Armenians, the Kurds, the scattered Greek communities? These were issues that were not explained by Wilson. On the other hand, Venizelos realized that the US was the strongest country in the conference, and it was essential to win President Wilson over to the Greek cause. And in order to do that, he went along with Wilson's idea for the creation of a League of Nations, in whose context Greece would also have a greater say in international affairs. On the other hand, the territories, the Ottoman territories, which were contested by Greece, were largely inhabited by ethnically mixed populations. Solid Greek presence was only confirmed in large cities, islands, and coastal regions, not so in the Anatolian hinterland. And also in certain areas, as far as the Greek territorial plans were concerned, there was a lack of territorial continuity. For example, the Greeks were a minority in Western Thrace, but a majority in Eastern Thrace. And here we see a map of the Greek claims in the peace conference. All the yellow areas indicate areas stating populated by a majority of Greeks, according to the Greek presentation. As you can see, this also includes a large section of the western coast of Turkey and eastern Thrace. But what about the Pontus and Constantinople? Despite strong Greek presence in the Pontus, Venizelos did not claim it for Greece due to its great distance prohibiting its defense by Greece. He also did not claim Constantinople for two reasons. Firstly, because its Greek population did not form a majority, and secondly, because he was aware that the other great powers were interested in it. However, he expected that a successful Greek administration in Ionia would eventually lead to a Greek annexation of Constantinople. Now, so far so good about as far as the Greeks were concerned, but what about the general situation in Turkey? There were many complications there. American idealism concerning the fate of Christians in Asia Minor gradually faded due to a lack of interest for American presence on the ground. On the other hand, Britain, France, and Italy expressed strong preference for mandates over parts of the Ottoman Empire where they had strong economic and political interests. And in this context, we have a situation of Italy versus Greece. Italy had failed to secure guarantees of occupation over parts of Turkey during World War I. Thus, Greek and Italian aspirations in Western Turkey coincided in areas such as Smyrna and the neighboring Dodecanese Islands. Here we have a nice picture of painting, rather, of Smyrna or Izmir in the late 18th century. And you can see the port and the city extending over to a nearby mountain. this is now going back to the problem between Greece and Italy. This is how Lloyd George viewed the Italian attitude. Italian statesmen were resolved that there should be no rival to the Italian naval power in the Eastern Mediterranean. A larger Greece with ports on the coast of Asia Minor and with a maritime population would always be a constant menace when allied to more formidable naval powers to the control of the Mediterranean, which has been Italy's historical aim. The struggle over Smyrna, Thrace, and the islands was the first manifestation of the policy of making the Mediterranean an Italian lake. And this is how a modern historian, a British historian, sees the same issue. In Asia Minor, France and Britain were agreed that Greece should obtain a large zone, though smaller than that claimed by Venizelos. The Americans disagreed. Their statistics showed the Greeks to be in a minority in every sanjak except that of Smyrna itself, and they found the separation of the Smyrna zone from the interior to be undesirable on economic grounds. The Italians refused to discuss the claim at all. They argued with justice that the Smyrna zone could not be taken in isolation from the general political settlement in Anatolia. They held also that Smyrna was the subject of commitments, the Treaty of London and the Saint-Jean-de-Maurienne Agreement, which conflicted with the Greek claim and which had priority. This is a statement by Sir Michael Welland-Smith, who has written a nice book on the entitled The Ionian Vision on the Greek Adventure in Anatolia. But despite all this, there was a decision of Smyrna, as we know, and the timeline on that started in late April 1919, when Italy failed to obtain concessions in Dalmatia, resulting in a boycott of discussions on mandates in Turkey. On the 6th of May at 2:45 p.m., fearing a preemptive unauthorized Italian landing in Smyrna, Wilson, Lloyd George, and Clemenceau asked Venizelos whether Greece has troops available for a landing on Smyrna. Venizelos replied, "We are ready." What is Sir Michael Welland-Smith's view on that? President Wilson would have put the devil into Smyrna if that would have kept the Italians out. Lloyd George would happily have allowed the Italians in if he had not felt a deeper sympathy with the aspirations of the Greeks. Clemenceau felt less strongly. He gave his word, but was to qualify and regret it. On the 15th of May, the 1st Division of the Hellenic Army started landing at Smyrna. However, misinformation and mismanagement of the landing led to extensive disorder in the city. Greek troops were shot at from the Ottoman army barracks. Turkish troops were consecutively arrested, and some were shot while on custody. Here we have two pictures of the Greek landing in Smyrna, the disembarking of material and war material, and to the right, the parade of the Greek troops in a very congested environment, as you can see, with no precaution separating the viewers from the troops. Here we have two documents to the left, the announcement of the landing by the commander of the 1st Division, Colonel Zafiriou, on the 2nd of May 1919, just a few days earlier. It's bilingual in Greece and the Greek and the old Ottoman script. And to the right, a picture of the confusion in the city during the landing. The casualties from this melee were estimated according to the Inter-Allied Commission inquiry as follows. The Greek army suffered 2 killed and 6 wounded. The Greek civilians, 20 killed, 20 drowned, and 60 wounded, totaling 100 people. And the Turkish civilians estimated that 300 to 400 killed or wounded. Of course, there was a formal inquiry on the Greek part, the administering authorities. And on the 15th of August, 1919, a court-martial presided by the Greek High Commissioner, Aristides Teriadis, seen second from left, on the photo to the right, facing camera, decided on the violent events of May 15 and 16. Thus, there was a conviction of 74 individuals, 48 Greeks, 13 Turks, 12 Armenians, and one Jew. This was not the end of the complication which arose straight after the Greek landing. In the following period, between 27th of June and the 4th of July. Following an earlier intercommunal violence in the city of Aydin, the situation escalated to a wide-scale armed conflict in and around the city, which started from a Turkish ambush of a Greek army patrol. The Greek army lost control of the situation, and several quarters of the city were burned, such as the Turkish on the 28th and 29th of June, and the Greek the following day, on the 30th of June. There were massacres of several thousand Turkish and Greek soldiers and civilians, including approximately 40 Greek Boy Scouts, which were tortured to death by Turkish irregulars. Here we see a picture, or perhaps an artistic depiction, I'm not sure, of a dead Greek Boy Scout with irregular Turkish soldiers. And to the right, a report of the Greek Boy Scout massacre in the Milwaukee Journal from the 22nd of August of 1919. All these events created a negative international impression on the Greek image and reputation. Greek troops were no longer viewed as implementing law and order, as was their original mission, but as occupation forces, and eventually Greece was seen as just another colonial power in the area. On the other hand, the Inter-Allied Commission of Inquiry, disregarding the long history of Greek and Turkish enmity, assigned most of the blame on Greek troops. On the other hand, the impact of on the Turks was different. Turkish nationalism was given a strong impetus, since the Greek landing in Smyrna was interpreted as a third territorial expansion of Greece over Turkish held territories since 1830. The first being the loss of Thessaly in 1891, which was annexed peacefully by Greece. And the second, the loss of Macedonia, Epirus, Crete, and the Eastern Aegean Islands in 1912 during the First Balkan War. The third expansion, the Greek landing, was seen as an open invasion of ancestral Turkish lands. And all this led to the formation of a Turkish nationalist movement. On the 19th of May, almost 103 years to the day, in a few days' time, Mustafa Kemal, the hero of the Battle of Gallipoli, landed at Samsun in the Pontus, having been appointed Inspector General of the 9th Ottoman Army, which was stationed in the eastern Turkish provinces. And the nationalist Turkish unity was solidified by a series of conferences. The earliest was the Erzurum Congress in July 1919, followed by the Sivas Conference in September. On the 12th of February 1920, there was an election which resulted in a new Ottoman parliament at Constantinople that declared the Ottoman independence, despite the fact that Constantinople itself was under foreign occupation. And in April 1920, the Grand National Assembly in Ankara, which substituted the newly elected Ottoman Parliament in Constantinople, since Ankara was a liberated territory, formed a provisional government under Mustafa Kemal. At this period, Kemal's closest associates were battle-hardened former World War I Turkish officers. The first was Ismet İnönü, Kemal's close associate in Syria and Palestine during 1917-18, later chief of the Ottoman General Staff of Western Front, seen here to the right with General Harrington. Another one was Kazım Karabekir, who fought in the Second Balkan War against the Bulgarians, decorated at Gallipoli, and subsequently commander of various Ottoman corps, including the one that defeated the British at Kutalamara, and later Ottoman troops that defeated the Armenians on the Eastern Front. Finally, the most interesting perhaps is Nureddin Pasha, with an early history of being an aide-de-camp of the chief of the Ottoman army in the Greek-Turkish War of 1897, later participating also in the British, the siege of the British at Kutalamara, becoming deputy governor of Aydin and commander of the 17th Corps in 1819, and a former strong opponent of Archbishop Chrysostomos, Metropolitan Chrysostomos of Smyrna, who, however, managed to have him removed from his command before May 1919. Later, Nureddin became commander of the central Turkish army, responsible for the genocide of the Pontic Greeks. And in June 1922, he became commander of the first of two Ottoman armies that later attacked the Greeks in Anatolia. Finally, being responsible for the atrocities in Smyrna in September 1922. Here you see him to the left of Kemal Atatürk. In early 1920, the era of occupation of Constantinople turned to a de facto following the dissolution of the Ottoman parliament, which moved to Ankara, as I mentioned, and the stationing of the opening station of British troops in key points of the city. There followed the San Remo conference in late April 1920, which decided to implement the decisions on mandates on former Ottoman territories. In the midst of all that, there was a brief Turkish civil war in between April and June 1920, when under British pressure and guidance, the new Ottoman Sultan, Mehmed VI, formed a new army to combat Kemalist nationalist forces. In the Battle of Izmit, Nikomedia, between the 15th and 17th of June, the Sultan's troops were repelled nationalist attacks with British assistance. However, their inefficiency became apparent to the British general, who requested 27 English divisions as a substitute to the Sultan's army. The request was denied, but the Sultan's troops were disbanded anyway by late June 1920. It was during this period that we have another massacre of Greeks in Turkey, when irregulars committed crimes against local Greeks in the area of Bithynia. A prime example was a village of Fulajik, 70 kilometers southeast of Constantinople and approximately 20 kilometers northwest of Nicaea, which was inhabited by 1,800 Turkish-speaking Greeks, who on 23rd of July 1920 suffered the attack of 600 Turkish irregulars that entered the village, torturing and killing most of the inhabitants. Here we have a picture of the villages of Fulajik, and to the right, book in English by journalist, a Greek journalist at the time, Kostas Faltaits, under the title The Genocide of the Greeks in Turkey. During this period, between June and September 1920, there was a Greek summer offensive, being the result of, as I mentioned, lack of reliable forces to implement law and order in northwestern Turkey, and the permission to the Greek army to occupy the southern coast of the Sea of Marmara. Thus, with British military assistance, the Greek army advanced as far as Ushak, 200 kilometers inland, occupying cities such as Panormos, Bandirma, present Bandirma, Mudania, Iznik, Nicaea, Izmit, Nikomedia, and also Bursa, the first Ottoman capital. Here we see a famous painting, picture which shows in the center with the white hair, Commander-in-Chief General Paraskevopoulos, and to his left, pointing on the map, General Pangalos, Lieutenant General Pangalos, the chief and his second in command of the Greek General Staff. And in the aftermath of the operations in that region, we have a picture to the left of General Paraskevopoulos and King Alexander, Greek King Alexander, and to the right, Turkish POW. On the 10th of August of 1920, we have the climax of the high point, rather, of the Greek successes in Asia Minor, when the Ottoman Grand Vizier Damat Ferit Pasha was forced to sign the peace treaty with the victors of World War I, minus Russia, of course, at the porcelain factory in Sèvres, 10 kilometers southwest of Paris. By its closes, the Ottoman Empire would be partitioned, and there would be an allied administration over most territories inhabited by non-Turks. In that context, France, Britain, and Italy implemented the provisions of the Sykes-Picot Treaty. Another slide is pictured here. To the left, we have the vizier, Grand Vizier Damat Ferit Pasha leaving conference, and to the right, the Turkish Senator Hadi Pasha signing the treaty. According to the treaty, the region of Smyrna would remain nominally under Ottoman sovereignty, but administered by Greece. Its final status was to be decided after 5 years by a local plebiscite overseen by the Greek the League of Nations. Further Greek annexations included Eastern Thrace, the islands of Imbros and Tenedos, and islands of the Sea of Marmara. And in this map, we see in light in strong yellow color the areas taken by Greece. Here we have a stamp with Venizelos signing the treaty, and to the right, his pen, as preserved nowadays. What were the views of Venizelos, the long-term views of Venizelos on the issue of mixed populations in Turkey? In much earlier than the Treaty of Sèvres, on the 30th of December 1918, soon after the end of World War I hostilities, in a memorandum submitted to the Paris Peace Conference, he had analyzed how he envisaged new territorial status in Turkey. And then he said the following: should an autonomous state be created in Western Asia Minor, due to its population, the economic and cultural supremacy of the Greek element and its prevalent position in these lands for three centuries in an uninterrupted manner, such a state would be essentially Greek. However, hundreds of thousands of Greeks would still be left under the jurisdiction of the Turkish government of Central Asia Minor. There can be only one remedy for this evil. Under the peace treaty, the Turkish government would be obliged to buy out the land property of Greeks living in its territory and wishing to migrate to Greek Asia Minor. The Greek government would do the same with the land property of Ottomans wishing to migrate to Turkish Asia Minor. In this way, one could wish that in the space of a few years, the population of the remaining Turkish state would consist almost entirely of Muslims. Other significant provisions of the treaty included the establishment of a free and independent Armenia whose borders with Turkey were to be decided by an American arbitration. The Armenian territory was to incorporate the Vilayet of Trebizond in Eastern Pontus, and the Allied expectations were that Greek control over the regions of Osmina and the strong Armenian state to would contain or neutralize Turkey in central Anatolia. This is how Armenia was supposed to be under the Treaty of Sèvres, containing large sections of Turkey, as you can see. But the response of the nationalist Turks was very strong. The treaty was denounced strongly by the Turkish nationalist movement, and Turkish signatories were stripped of their citizenship by the Grand National Assembly in Ankara. As a matter of fact, very few of them managed to ever return to Turkey. This is what Kemal himself said on the Treaty of Sèvres. A new Turkish state has been born out of the old Ottoman Empire. This must be recognized. New Turkey shall have its rights recognized, just as any other nation. The Treaty of Sèvres is so nefarious a death sentence for the Turkish nation that we expect no friend will pronounce it. Even during conversation, I abhor the mention of this treaty. We could not entertain any relation based on confidence with any nation which has not banished the Treaty of Sèvres from its minds. So far as we are concerned, no such treaty exists. That was recorded in 1921. So in this context, the Kemalist forces managed to cancel the provisions on Greater Armenia. On the 28th of September, they invaded, Kemalist forces invaded territories bestowed to Armenia, and by the 30th of October, Kars was taken by Kemalists. On the 18th of November, Armenians requested a ceasefire, and 10 days later, Armenia was stabbed in the back as it was invaded by Soviet forces. On the 2nd of December, the Treaty of Alexandropol, signed by a new Armenian government controlled by the Soviets, was signed with the General Kazim Karabekir. Armenia was forced to disarm and hand over territories gained by the Treaty of Sèvres. Thus, Kemalist forces took control of most of the Southern Caucasus, and by the Treaty of Kars, signed on the 13th of October 1921, between the Soviets and the Kemalists, the new status quo was confirmed and Armenia was officially reduced to its present area, to the right part of the map. At this time, however, Greece was celebrating the Greater Greece. But the French were looking for ways to pull out of Turkey. Someone said the treaty was unpopular in France, where the colonial lobby denounced it as a sellout. The French government, for its part, could no longer afford the 500 million francs per year for the French zone of occupation in the southern part of Asia Minor or the losses. By the start of 1920, the Turks were waging an increasingly effective guerrilla war. Over 500 soldiers were casualties in the first 2 weeks of February alone. The French were forced to abandon one post after another, and this threatened their hold in Syria in the south, as stated by Margaret Macmillan. Also, during this period, the fateful turn of events occurred in Greece. On the 25th of October, King Alexander, aged just 27 years, died unexpectedly of septicemia. On the 14th of November, despite expectations, Venizelos lost the general election, including his own parliamentary seat, gaining just 118 out of 369 seats. 3 days later, Venizelos left Greece for Nice, nominally terminating his political career, which did not actually occur. And on the 5th of December, the new anti-Venizelist government had a referendum which approved of the restoration of King Constantine, who had been overthrown in 1917. 2 days before the referendum, foreseeing the outcome, the great powers presented the new Greek government with an ultimatum, stating that the French, the British, French, and Italian governments declare publicly that the restoration to the throne of Greece of a king whose disloyal attitude and conduct towards the Allies during the war caused them great embarrassment and loss could only be regarded as a ratification of his hostile acts. This step would create a new and unfavorable situation in the relations between Greece and the Allies, and in that case, the three governments reserved to themselves complete liberty in dealing with the situation thus created. We enter 1921, a year of failed opportunities, as I call it. In January, the Greek army and the new leadership advanced as far as Eskisehir here, facing strong resistance by the reorganized Kemalist forces, forcing it to withdraw to its bases. Shortly afterwards, between the 21st of February and the mid of March, an international conference was held in London, failing to bring Kemalists in line with the Sultan's government or to persuade the Greek government to withdraw from Smyrna. The situation turned in favor of the Kemalists as on the 9th of March, a peace treaty was signed in Cilicia between France and the Kemalist movement, ending temporarily the hostilities in that part of Turkey. And that meant, of course, that the local Armenians were left defenseless and open to massacres. A week later, the Treaty of Moscow between the Soviets and the Kemalist movement settled the territorial issues and established amicable relations between the two. In late June, as far as the 5th of July, the Italian troops withdrew from the region of Antalya in southern Turkey, and the Kemalists started receiving regular caches of money and ammunition from France, Italy, and the Soviets. On its part, the Greek leadership decided on a full-scale war with Kemalists on two assumptions, that first, the expectation of British support, and secondly, the fear that termination of hostilities between Kemalists and the French in Cilicia would divert Turkish forces against the Greek army. So, between late March and 6 April, the Greek army started the Greek pincer offensive on two fronts, but failed to encircle the Turks. So the Greeks once again withdrew to Ushak. However, the British had not lost faith in Greece, and according to the British military attaché and his inspection of the Greek army, he stated that the Greek army of Asia Minor, which now stood ready and eager to advance, was the most formidable force the nation had put into the field. Its morale was high. Judged by Balkan standards, its staff was capable, its discipline and organization good. Actually, this was not the real picture, but let's stick to this for the moment. So in the summer of 1921, we have military developments between Greece and Turkey. In the 11th of June, King Constantine assumed the nominal command of the army of Asia Minor, numbering approximately 200,000 men. During July, the Greek army advanced as far as the river Sakarya, or Sangarios in Greek, conquering the cities of Afyon, Karahisar, Kutahi, and Eskisehir. In August, between 13th August and 10th September, the Greek army advanced further to the east towards Ankara, breaching two of the three Turkish defense lines, before withdrawing again to bases in Eskişehir and Afyonkarahisar. And this map shows the gradual Greek expansion from the Sanjak of Izmir to the northwest of Turkey, further to the east between Eskişehir and Kütahya, and finally the march towards Ankara. At this period, the Kemalists have started another persecution, or continued another persecution of Greeks in the Pontus, fearing the appearance of a second front. So in the summer of 1921, Nureddin Pasha, who had the military command of the Pontus, ordered the deportation of 21,000 Greeks inland, essentially forcing them on death marches. And in the period between August and September, so-called independence tribunal in Amasya summarily condemned hundreds of Pontic Greeks on false charges of conspiring for the independence of the Pontus. During the Amasya trials in late September 1921, 155 to 168 prominent Pontic Greeks were hanged publicly in Amasya. The exact number is still under question. And these included politicians, intellectuals, businessmen, journalists, and clergymen. Also during July 1921, the gang of Topalos Managa, a notorious cutthroat of irregular, his band of irregular Laz troops, massacred the Greek and remaining Armenian population of Mezifon or Masovan, 40 kilometers west of Amasya. There were new diplomatic victories for the Kemalists in the autumn of 1921. I mentioned earlier the Treaty of Kars in October between the Soviets and Kemalists. On the 21st of October, also the Treaty of Ankara terminated the Franco-Turkish War, with French withdrawing from the cities in southeast Turkey in exchange for economic concessions in areas under Kemalist control. As Macmillan, Margaret Macmillan put it, France got economic concessions while Ataturk gained something much more important, recognition by a leading power. Here we have the picture of the Treaty of in English, and to the right, the French negotiator, Henri Franklin Bouillon, with his met in Anu. Unfortunately, there follows a Greek deadlock between the autumn of 1921 and the spring of 1922. The Greek government struggling at the time for a diplomatic success. However, it failed to secure either financial assistance, that is a British loan, or an active British diplomatic support. And the consequences were a demoralization of the Greek army, with suffering extensive desertions, and a psychological rift between the Greeks of Asia Minor and the Greek authorities. Lloyd George was unable to help at the time, stating, literally, to the Ecumenical Patriarch Meletius in the spring of 1922, I said it last week clearly to Mr. Gunaris and Mr. Baldadzis, the foreign minister. Personally, I'm a friend of Greece, but all my colleagues are against me, and I cannot be of any use to you. It is impossible, impossible. In late March 1922, the Paris Conference was attended by the foreign ministers of Britain, France, and Italy, proposing a three-month truce between Greece and the Kemalists in order first for the Greek army to withdraw peacefully from Asia Minor and for a new peace conference to be organized. However, the Kemalists refused, demanding immediate withdrawal of the Greek army. At the same time, the Greeks of Smyrna were trying to find a way out of the deadlock by forming a committee called the Defense of Asia Minor, which intended to take matters in its own hand, but lacked a prominent leader. As General Papoulos, the commander-in-chief of the Greek army in Asia Minor, and Venizelos, as well as Teliadis, the Greek high commissioner, refused to assume its leadership. The potential strength of a local Greek army was estimated at the time at perhaps 45 to 50,000 men. Also, during this period, the Greek Minister of Finance, Petros Protopapadakis, secured a forced loan by imposing the cutting of all Greek notes or paper money in half. The left half remaining in circulation, the right half used as a bond at half its original price. And thus this extra sum of 1.5 million drachmas was to be used for the demobilization of the Greek army. This is Protopapadakis to the left and the 100 drachma note cut in half to the right. In July 1922, the Greek army moved 3 infantry regiments and 2 battalions from Asia Minor to Eastern Thrace with a plan to force the Allies to take more active stance vis-a-vis the stalemate by threatening with a Greek occupation of Constantinople. However, the plan was foiled following an Allied announcement that they would, that the Greek army would be met by force. And there was an English bluff at the time on the 4th of August with Lord George speaking to the House of Commons and accusing in a way his own government of not allowing Greeks to conduct the war as they see they saw it fit. This speech was interpreted as follows. The speech was a bluff intended to keep up the Greeks' morale. It held out vague hopes but made no promises of aid. It was Lloyd George's final intervention, eccentric but consistent with his policy of encouraging Greece without committing Britain. The effect of the speech was to hasten the climax in Asia Minor for the Turks, anxious lest the speech might foreshadow practical measures of assistance for Greece, pushed on at a feverish pace with their plans for an offensive, as stated by Sir Michael Llewellyn Smith. This offensive started on the 26th of August with 12 Turkish divisions attacking 2 Greek ones at the Greek salient at Afyon Karahisar. Day later, the front collapsed with the GHQ in Izmina failing to understand the seriousness of the situation. So various commanders, Greek commanders, took situation in their own hands, acting independently of each other. On the 28th of August, the 1st and 2nd Greek corps started retreating westwards along the course of the railway line. But due to constant Turkish attacks, their cohesion broke down and a large section of the 2 corpses was encircled at the mountainous valley of Ali Veran, where approximately 25,000 Greek troops managed to break through. But in the last site of the last major battle of the Greek-Turkish War in Ali Veran, the 2nd of September, after 4 days of fighting, the remaining Greek force, approximately 5,000 troops and 500 officers under General Trikoupis, the commander in chief of the First Corps, surrendered. This is General Trikoupis, second from left to in the first row, with other Greek officers held in captivity. Greek forces continued their disorganized retreat to the Aegean coast, burning Turkish towns and villages along the way. On the 8th of September, they bypassed Smyrna, continuing towards the peninsula, the Erythraean peninsula. In Chesme, they started embarking Greek ships that carried them to the neighboring islands. On the same day, the High Commissioner Stergiadis and all the Greek civil servants abandoned Smyrna. And on the 16th of September, the last Greek troops left Asia Minor from Chesme. At this time, the Allied had a strong naval presence in Smyrna with 21 ships anchored at the city's port, including 2 battleships and their escort of cruisers and destroyer, 3 or later 4 American destroyers, 5 French ships, 2 Italian ships, and contingents of all these, from all these ships, sent ashore to guard the country's compounds and institutions. However, on strict orders to remain neutral. On the 9th of September, Turkish contingents entered Smyrna and soon chaos spread in the city as Turks, both soldiers and the regulars, went on the rampage. On the same evening, Metropolitan Chrysostom was carried to the Turkish headquarters where Nureddin Pasha, newly appointed commander of the city, handed him over to the mob to be lynched. The following day, we saw the Armenians of Smyrna massacred by Turkish troops and mob. What was the actual responsibility of Nureddin Pasha in these events? As stated by famous British biographer of Kemal, Andrew Mango, he stated that only determined, impartial commander could have prevented large-scale disorder. But Nureddin was determined only on revenge. 2 months after the fire of Izmir, Mustafa Kemal criticized Nureddin for trying to attribute to himself alone the patriotic effort of all members of the army to expel non-Muslims from Western Anatolia. But clearly, care was needed. Nureddin's readiness to exile and destroy the Greeks and Armenians in Anatolia, Mustafa Kemal went on to say, was nothing more than demagogy, which should be avoided for fear of damaging the national interest. In the early afternoon of 13th of September, flames erupted in the Armenian quarters of Smyrna, spreading fast. And by the 22 of September, when the fire had died out, it had consumed the whole of the Greek, Levantine, and Armenian quarters, the most prosperous part of the city, with the Turkish and Jewish quarters spared due to the direction of the wind. The Turkish advance had forced large numbers of Christians from inland to seek refuge in Smyrna, but the fire forced both Smyrna's Christians and the refugees to congest in the port. The Allied ships were eventually forced to, by the extent of the developing humanitarian tragedy, to assist their evacuation. So approximately 200,000 people were evacuated, but again, another 30,000 Christian men were deported to the interior of Turkey as forced labor, most dying in the process. Following events of 24th of September, thanks to the efforts of the American pastor Asa Jennings, Greek ships were allowed to enter Smyrna's port and carry the remaining refugees, mostly women and children. Now, we have a set of few testimonies which lay the blame for the fire. Certain Miss Minnie Mills, dean of the Intercollegiate Institute of Smyrna, an American lady, said, "I could plainly see the Turks carrying the tins of petroleum into the Armenian houses, from which, in each instance, fire burst forth immediately afterward. There was not an Armenian inside, the only persons visible being Turkish soldiers of the regular army in smart uniforms." Mrs. King Birch, wife of an American missionary, said, "On the other hand, I went up into the tower of the American College in Paradise and with a pair of field glasses could plainly see Turkish soldiers setting fire to houses. I could see Turks lurking in the fields shooting at Christians." An American lady associated with the American missions in Turkey stated in a letter from the 21st of August, or September, sorry, "After the third day of the occupation of Kemal's army, fires began to break out in the Christian quarter of the city. I myself saw a Cheta carrying a lot of firewood on his back up an alley, from which later on the fire that caught our building came. It is quite clear in my mind that there was a definite part to burn out the Christian quarter after it had been looted. The time for setting the great fire was when the wind was blowing away from the Turkish quarter. Two firemen, Sergeant Chorbagis and Manuel Katsaros, both Greek, would later testify in court witnessing that they witnessed Turkish soldiers setting fire to the buildings. When Katsaros complained, one of them commented, 'You have your orders and we have ours. This is Armenian property, our orders are to set fire to it.'" A biographer of Kemal, Lord Kinross, said that more probably the fire started when the Turks, rounding up the Armenians to confiscate their arms, besieged a band of them in a building in which they had taken refuge. Deciding to burn them out, they set it alight with petrol. Meanwhile, the Armenians started other fires to divert the Turks from their main objective. The quarter was on the outskirts of the city, but a strong wind, for which they had not allowed, quickly carried flames toward the city. The flames were being spread by the looters and doubtless also by Turkish soldiers, paying off scores. Ismet himself chose to declare that the Greeks had planned to burn the city. And however, a nationalist Turkish journalist present in events called Salih Rifki Atay said things in a different way. "The plunderers helped spread the fires. Why were we burning down Izmir? Were we afraid that if waterfront Konaks, hotels, and taverns stayed in place, we would never be able to get rid of the minorities? This does not solely derive from an urge for destruction. There is also some feeling of inferiority in it. It was as if anywhere that resembled Europe was destined to remain Christian and foreign and to be denied to us." The Austrian chief of the Smyrna Fire Department, named Paul Greskovich, said that his, as cited by Heath Lowry, an American historian, that his own firemen, as well as Turkish guards, had shot down many Armenian young men disguised either as women or as Turkish irregular soldiers who were caught setting fires during Tuesday night, the 12th of September, and Wednesday, the 13th, morning. Despite the defeat of the Greeks, Lloyd George wanted the Allies to retain control of the Dardanelles and Constantinople. However, France, Italy, and Yugoslavia thought otherwise. And in the late days of September and early October, there was a conference at Mudania between the Allies and the Kemalists. At the end of October, an armistice was signed there, with the Greek troops forced to evacuate eastern Thrace within 15 days, and the region was to be returned to Turkish control 30 days later. The final arrangement was made in Lausanne during the Lausanne Conference of 1922, late 1922 and early first half of 23, which acknowledged the new status quo vis-a-vis Greece, Turkey, and the Near East. The final settlement provided for the exchange of Christian population of Turkey in eastern Thrace with the Muslim of Greece. That is approximately 1.5 million of Christians, Ottoman Christians, for approximately 350 to 400,000 Muslims. That is the end of the story. I have a short bibliography for those who would like to have a better understanding of the issues. I hope that I have not tired you very much. I would like to thank you for your attendance, and I'm open to your questions now.
Thank you very much, Dr. Nikoloudis, for your very, very interesting lecture. Let me see if I have any questions here. I see, let's see. Okay, to give the chance to the audience to type their questions, let me pose one question or two first. What is the judgment of prominent historians on the goals that the Greeks pursued during the First World War and after and in its aftermath, and on what was the outcome of the whole venture?
Well, as I broadly explained, it apparently was quite convenient for the Allies to force Greece into their side, a fact which in fact contributed to the Allied victory, since the collapse of the Macedonian front, in which the Greek troops played a prominent part, was the beginning of the end of the war. However, that was not the case after the war. First of all, because public opinion in all Allied countries was against any kind of military intervention, further military intervention and conflicts anywhere in Europe or the Middle East. And secondly, because the Allied governments, with the exclusion of the British one, and that again gradually also withdrawing, were against a strong Greek presence in Turkey, because they viewed it as going against their own financial interests, mainly in Turkey. They knew that there were Greek populations there, which in earlier years had served and worked for the British or the French with their own companies there. So they didn't want an open Greek presence, because that, of course, would antagonize their own interests. And the combination of these reasons resulted in the Allied withdrawal, as I said, from the Greek side, and the eventual deadlock, as they didn't want to give any kind of facility for, if you like, an organized Greek withdrawal without guaranteeing anything for the Christians, not just the Greeks, also the Armenians of the Ottoman Empire, who would be left at the mercy of the Turks, as it actually happened eventually.
Okay, I have a question here from Kostas Alagiorgas. Can you discuss why Venizelos advocated the Greek population exchange?
Well, obviously he had seen far ahead of his time. I may remind you that this view was stated in the end of the last day of December 1918. That is 4 years before the destruction of the Greek army. So he could see from his experience with events in Crete, where he started his political career, and with the Balkan Wars and so on, that there was no way different nationalities at the time could, especially from different creeds like the Muslims and Christians, could live peacefully together, because it was a time of expression of strong nationalist movement, as we know, during the First World War, and of course, right afterwards. So he planned, if you like, exchange of population, Christian and Muslim, within the area of Asia Minor. That is, assuming that Greece would be able to hold onto the Smyrna territory, and that the Turkish nationalism would be contained with allied support. May I also add here that Venizelos never had in mind that Greece could hold on to Smyrna and its surrounding zone on its own means. It would be inevitable for him, for Venizelos, that the British would have to send troops as well to support the Greek cause. However, if you remember, that was not how things developed, because in 1920, when the Greeks advanced towards the northwest Turkey, it was to assist the British troops, who were not capable of holding the area for themselves. So instead of the British assisting the Greeks, it was the other way around. And up until the end, despite the fact that the British wanted to hold on to the Straits, as I said, and the Sea of Marmara, they were not willing to commit any troops for that purpose, and that's why they were drawn rather to the Mudania conference and forced to go along with the acknowledgement of the Turkish victory.
The next question is from Salas Koptoglu. What was the main reason of the Greek defeat in Asia Minor?
It's difficult to pin it down to one single reason. There was a combination of reasons. This quicksand, if you like, of changing political environment in the space of the 3 years between 1919 and 22, both in the international level with the changing attitude of the great powers, also in Greece with the change of government and the despite the fact that the Venizelist party was going along with the campaign, the rift which had been caused by the split of 1917 between Constantine and Venizelos remained to the end of the campaign in Turkey and even further on until the mid-30s, if you like. So these were the main contributing factors, as well as the lack of financial and military means for supporting the Greek campaign, and the eventual demoralization of the Greek morale, both on the front and in the in Greece and Smyrna as well. So I think these were the main reasons, but it's very difficult to pin down, as I said, just one main factor for the Greek losses.
Do you think that if Venizelos had won the elections, that the outcome would be different?
From what I've read, and I can judge myself, not really. Venizelos might have handled the situation more smoothly, if you like, and perhaps come to a better arrangement with the Allies, so that the eventual Greek withdrawal would be would not end up in destruction as it did, but would be handled more in a more capable manner. Of course, this is all hypothetical. There's no way of stating this as a definite eventuality. So one guess is as good as another.
Okay, the next question is from Vani Konomu. How has the history of the various Greek Turkish wars and the conquest treaties you have discussed impact the present situation in Greece in respect to Turkish incursions over Greek islands by military jet overflights?
That's an interesting point. Well, I don't expect that any serious Greek, if you like, has any ideas about reconquering the lost territories, not even Istanbul, where there are a few Greeks still living. I think most people just take the events of 1922 as a definite end of the story, if you like. As far as the previous hostilities were concerned. It seems that for the Turks, for some reason, not just politically, but more psychologically among the general population, the Treaty of Sèvres still remains as a nightmare, something which they realized led almost to the destruction of the Turkish state. So in the back of their minds, perhaps, there is a fear that this might reoccur on as far as the Greeks are concerned. It would seem to me that they might have been justified to some extent with events in Cyprus in the 60s and early 70s, which led to the Turkish invasion. But nowadays, as far as the all the violations of the airspace are concerned in the Greek territorial waters, I think it's just an expression of the current Megali there, if you like, on the Turkish side. I mean, they have perhaps dreams or visions of rejuvenating the Greek state, and perhaps trying to reach its old frontiers, not as it would have been at the end of the First World War, but again, as much as they can. Again, it's just a hypothesis, but that's my idea of it.
The next question is from Tasos Chichis. How much was the Ion Dragoumis political influence to the Asia Minor catastrophe, as well as the Ting's political influence on the public?
I don't think that Dragoumis played any part in that situation. First of all, as we know, he was executed, literally executed, by paramilitary Venizelist bands on the day the Treaty of Sèvres was, just a few days later, when Venizelos was ambushed, if you like, in the train station in Paris on his way back to Greece by two anti-Venizelist ex-officers who failed to kill him. And Dragoumis was killed in revenge, if you like, by Venizelists in Athens, despite the fact that he had no association whatsoever with these events. Dragoumis was an idealist and a visionary, if you like, but he had his ideas were leaning towards coexistence of Greeks and Turks and an eventual substitution of the Ottoman Empire by Greek Empire, infiltrated by, if you like, by Greeks, by Ottoman Greeks. But this was impossible after the First World War, with the spread of nationalism, as I mentioned earlier. There was no way that there could be any coexistence in any multinational empire. As we know, the Austro-Hungarian Empire was also dissolved, despite the fact that tensions there between different populations were much fewer than between Greeks and Turks. Also, the Russian Empire, which was a multinational empire, collapsed through the Bolshevik movement. So he was out of time, if you like, by the end of the First World War. That doesn't mean that he wouldn't have contributed ideologically to a discussion and a debate, perhaps, if you like, on the Greek presence in Asia Minor and how that could have developed. But he, as I said, eventually he didn't play any role. So he was out of the game really early on.
The next question is from Savas Koksoglu. What was the role of Admiral Bristol, the American High Commissioner, in the course of these events?
That is another very interesting issue, which I didn't really touch during my presentation because I didn't want to expand very much on every side issue, if you like. Admiral Bristol was the American in charge of American presence and American interests in the former Ottoman Empire, after the withdrawal of the American delegation from Paris with President Wilson. In fact, as things turn out, he turned to be an anti-Wilsonist, if you like. Where Wilson had envisaged a peaceful coexistence and the peaceful arrangement, if you like, of the interests of the Allies and the Christians and the Muslims in Turkey, perhaps too much optimistically, Bristol was a downright pragmatist, but to the point of pushing aside the humanitarian interests shown by not just President Wilson, but also by a large part of Americans due to the acknowledgement of the Armenian genocide and the Greek genocide as well, which gave a moral, strong moral argument to the Greeks and Armenians. Bristol eventually did away with these ideas, and he tried to promote financial interests of American companies in Turkey through this so-called open door policy. And in that, in this respect, he tried to antagonize the British, French, and Italians by keeping up a close relationship with the Kemalist movement. On the other hand, we have to admit that the British, the American flotilla he commanded, both in the Pontic region and the Black Sea, and especially in the Izmirna events, played a prominent role both in spreading out the news of the genocide that was unfolding, and particularly in the case of Mirna, in assisting the fleeing refugees. That doesn't mean that his overall policy was successful, because despite the fact that he remained in Turkey until 1928, if I remember well, this policy of keeping a close relationship and the bond with the Ottomans, the Turks, did not really assist American interests, because Americans did not manage to get a better position in Turkey vis-a-vis the British or the French or Italians.
The next question is from Pastor Chichis. What economic allowances and deals were made by the English and French with Kemal that influenced the abandonment of the Greek army?
I don't think the British had made any formal agreements with Kemal until 1922 and the collapse of the Greek presence. The French did make the agreement, design the agreement, as I said, the Ankara agreement in 1921, but again, just on a vague promise, if you like, on the part of the Kemalist movement. They didn't really have a direct impact on, they didn't make a direct profit from this arrangement, because they were only trying to cut their losses in Cilicia and Syria. However, on the other hand, they did help the Kemalists with guns and ammunition, as also did the Soviets and the Italians. So in that respect, despite the financial interests, they paid more attention to the military aspect of the circumstances, hoping that after the victory, the Kemalist victory, they could make better arrangements. But that's a different story. During the events leading to 1922, they didn't have any serious financial gains as far as Turks were concerned.
Okay, let me see if I have any other question. I don't see, let me see. Okay, there is another one here from Savas again. Why, in your opinion, did Venizelos propose that Kemal Atatürk be considered for the Nobel Prize?
That was a later story. I think that happened after the Greek-Turkish friendship agreement in 1928 or 30, if I remember well. when the exchange of populations was finalized and the issue of compensations was completely settled by Greece really writing off any demands of compensations from Turkey for the purpose of establishing more firm relations with modern Turkey and bearing all grudges, if you like. I think just a political movement on behalf of Venizelos. He didn't, I'm not sure whether he actually considered Kemal such a pacifist. Events had shown things in a different light during the war, the Greek-Turkish war. But let's not forget that the late 20s and early 30s was a period of international illusions, if you like, as we saw also in the case of Mussolini and Hitler. The rise of strong leaders in various countries was seen probably at the time as a way of establishing and fermenting peace in Europe, in the Middle East. It turned out quite the opposite, but at that time it was different in the late 20s and early 30s.
Okay, I don't see any other question. Let me ask a final question. Were not the terms of the Treaty of Sevres imposed to Turkey by the leading Western powers very unrealistic or quite unrealistic? Was not it inevitable that it would lead to another war with the Turks in one way or another?
That's another interesting question also. The way to see this, to find the answer, is by remembering that the Treaty of Sevres took place almost a year and a half after the armistice of 1918. Not 1919, but at the end of the first half of 1920. And that is an indication of the complication of the peace settlement, which was an offshoot, if you like, of the Eastern question that had been troubling the European powers for a few centuries going backwards. So, despite the fact that Russia was out of the picture, the other three powers could not compromise with their own interests and so on. And they could not decide straight away on dissolving Turkey as they did with the German Empire or the Austro-Hungarian Empire. So the compromise that was reached in the Treaty of Sevres was largely due to Venizelos and his personal influence on the war leaders during the peace conference. However, as soon as Venizelos was out of the picture, and that happened as you saw a few months later in November 1920, there was no stabilizing influence as far as Greece was concerned vis-a-vis the other powers. So all hell broke loose, if you like. No one was willing to contain the Kemalists. That's why they were able to do away with the Armenian in just the space of 2 or 3 months. And from then on, also to do away with the French threat in southeastern Turkey, they did away with one enemy after the other, if you like. That was a smart movement on Kemal and his staff. First the Armenians, then the French in the Cilician, the Turkish-Syrian border, and then the Greeks. And I think that this was an indication of the political genius, if you like, of Kemal, as well as the fact that he had a group of very good staff officers in his entourage, like the ones I mentioned, which was not the case, for example, with the Greek army. Because when the Greek army started invading the interior of Anatolia, its general staff was a mishmash, if you like. The old staff, which I showed in the picture of 1919 with General Paraskevopoulos, had largely been disbanded because they're all Venizelist officers. Papoulas, who was in charge, had literally been pulled out of prison after the fall of Venizelos and put in command of the Greek troops, without having any military experience of the First World War or any general staff experience, as was the case, for example, of King Constantine, who studied with the German military staff in Berlin. So, as of the other staff officers, Sarianis, who was a Venizelist, was allowed to remain, but he had disputes with other staff officers, and Papoulas, knowing that he was inexperienced, would just sign off any proposition they would put forward to him and suggest it to the Greek government, which, on the other hand, would try to impose its political views on the army without considering the actual situation on the front. So this was a lack of understanding, if you like, or irresponsible attitude on both sides, the military and the politicians, which was another factor that led to the collapse. The fact that they kept they imagined that by keeping up a large front in the interior of Turkey, they would force the Turks to compromise. But the Turks didn't need to compromise because they had already gained ground by force. And they could see that they had the upper hand also in the political scene. So that was the course of events.
And okay, I don't see any other question. I will have a last question, then we will close it. Would it be possible for the Greeks to hold at least Eastern Thrace, where, as you mentioned, the majority were Greeks?
Militarily, yes, because there were no Turkish troops there at the time. There was the British zone of the Dardanelles and the Sea of Marmara, which was acted as a buffer zone, if you like. So there would be no trouble in holding on to Thrace. But the Allies didn't want it because they wanted one single power to control the Dardanelles and the Bosporus and the Sea of Marmara, the passage to the Black Sea. And if that could not be Greece, because Greece had failed on the one leg, the Asia Minor, that would have to be Turkey, since no other power wanted to, except the British, to hold on to the old agreements. And the British, as I said earlier, did not want to commit any troops. And let's not remember that shortly after the Treaty of the Armistice of Moudania, Lloyd George lost power for good. He had been in office since 1916, I think. But at that point, he had no other support in his own party, and he was kicked out of power. So the strongest supporter of Greece, even by himself and without any support, was also pushed out of the game. I don't think that realistically there was any chance for Greece to hold on to Eastern Thrace.
Thank you very much, Dr. Nikoloudis, for this very, very interesting and informative lecture. So we close the lecture.
Thank you for your